Hello and welcome to join us with Wesley Methodist Church in Reading. This is our online service, but you are welcome to join us at 10:30 any Sunday morning. That's our live service in church if you are within shouting distance of Reading. On this service today we have June Hardcastle, who's going to be preaching on the miracles of the wedding at Cana. So let us rejoice as we sing our first hymn, which is "Great is Your Faithfulness."
And our prayer of intercession. Lord God, you are a strong rock in whom we trust. all our confidence rests in you. Deep in our mother's wombs, you knew us. Before our limbs were formed, you yearned for us. When we were still unseen, you cherished the thought of us. When we are silent, you understand our thoughts. When we shout and rail, you hear our plea and our uncertainty. When we stammer, you form the words in our mouths. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, do give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, and for the means of grace, and for the hope of glory. Also, we ask you to give us the due sense of all your mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. And that in this holy fellowship, to approach each other, not as strangers, but as pilgrims and travelers together, in mission and service to the world. Amen.
The reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 62, verses 1 to 5. For Zion's sake I will not keep silent, For Jerusalem's sake, I will not remain quiet till her vindication shines out like the dawn, her salvation like a blazing torch. The nations will see your vindication, and all kings your glory. You will be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will bestow. You will be a crown of splendour in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. No longer will they call you deserted or name your land desolate, but you will be called Hephzibah and your land Beulah, for the Lord will take delight in you and your land will be married. As a young man marries a young woman, so will your builder marry you. As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God rejoice over you.
This reading is from John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I knew Nigel's mother for 47 years before she died. In all that time, I never heard her give a brief outline of a story. For example, what she could have said as, "I was in the town and bumped into Daphne, we had a bit of a chat and came back together on the bus," would have been something like this. "Well, I caught the 33 bus from the end of the road this morning. It was running a bit late and it was full, but someone stood up and gave me a seat. It took so much longer than usual because of all the roadworks on the Tilehurst Road that seemed to be going on forever. And you'd be amazed at how dreadful the pavements are in Friar Street. I'm going to write a letter to the council. Someone will have an accident along there unless something is done. I went into WH Smith. I'm sure you get the picture." The lectionary gospel reading for today is rather like that. What could be recorded as Jesus went to a wedding, the wine ran out, he performed a miracle, so there was plenty of wine, and everyone said it was the best wine of the celebration. But what we do have is the story told in 233 words over 11 verses. And there are many reflections and sermons to be got from that, many themes which could carry us off into different directions. For example, at the outset, we're given a time frame on the third day. Now, to those of us in the know about this whole story of Jesus, there is more than an echo forward in time to the resurrection. Much to be said about how this story, the wedding at Cana in Galilee, links on with the third day he rose again. Or there's that place name, Cana. Cana has the meaning of the intertwining of many strands, And within that meaning, there are two uses. The first, reeds and twigs, which a bird uses to make a nest. And the second is acts of trade, which combine together to make a flourishing economy. So an interesting possible reflection on that theme, as John puts it in the first of the signs of who Jesus is, we could think about how this miracle reassures us that he prepares a home for us as the nesting birds prepare for its chicks, and how this miracle assures us that what he does will be led to an abundance. And also, what about the view it gives us of Mary? Mary, not much referred to in our Methodist way of life and worship, or even in mainstream Church of England, except at Christmas, of course, when our vision of her character is often limited by her image on Christmas cards, you know, eyes down, head covered. Yet, here in this story, she counters Jesus not wanting to be involved with her taking control and summoning the servants. This is a woman not frightened to speak up, a woman not frightened to take a lead, a woman who is confident, much to be explored there. Or what about those stone pots which were also used for the rites of purification? I could tell you more about those than probably you ever wish to know. And also, there's much significance in there being six water pots. Too much to summarise here, but you know, six has got an important numerical significance in the Bible. After 6 days, God rested and saw that everything was good. After 6 days, Moses and Joshua went up to Mount Sinai, where they saw the glory of the Lord. After 6 days, God called Moses to enter the cloud's midst. After 6 days, there was the glory of God on the mountain. The number six is important in Joshua, where we read that the Israelites marched around Jericho once a day for 6 days. And after 6 days, that's when things began to happen. And in the Mark recording of the transfiguration of Jesus, Mark 9, the story starts with after 6 days. So we're immediately going to expect some close encounter with something wonderful and glorious about God. And there are other reflections, and those of you who are Bible study group leaders and preachers and worship leaders will be able to think of many more things. But the question I now ask you is this. Okay, what's the message I'm going to bring you today from this story at the wedding of Cana in Galilee? Well, it's this. And I want us to focus on this. How was this miracle performed? Jesus told the servants to fill the six stone water pots with water, and it was the water that was changed into wine. Why? Why get the servants to go to the bother of filling up those pots when Jesus could surely just by a click of his fingers have filled them with wine? Jesus uses the most common element of our human life, water, the most needful, but surely the least exciting, the most ordinary, and he's able to change that least exciting, most ordinary, into the very best wine of the feast. So likewise, he is able to work within us who we consider ourselves to be quite ordinary, but for us, for whom he stretched out his arms on those blood-soaked planks of wood. And he is doing all this so that we become the very embodiment of the prophecy of Isaiah, which we heard in that Old Testament reading. You will be a crown of splendour in the Lord's hands, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. I love the bit in 2 Corinthians in chapter 4. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We're hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. And it goes on to say that is so the thanksgiving can abound to the glory of God. So just as that water in earthen vessels became the finest wine of the feast, so the treasure which is in us, these human vessels, will be a splendour by the hand of the Lord. One of the enduring hymns of our faith, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, has the magnificent last verse, Finish then thy new creation, pure and spotless let us be, let us see thy great salvation perfectly restored in thee, changed from glory into glory, till in heaven we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love and praise. So, folks, this is my message this morning. Have faith that Lord who can change water into wine is changing us, so that day by day we are more and more the embodiment of who he has destined us to be. Don't look on your imperfections, on your slowness to learn from him, and sometimes reluctance to follow. Look only on him who is able, on him who never turns away anyone who comes to him.
Lord our God, your mercy and forgiveness stretches out to us and includes all who come to you in repentance. We long to be all the treasure of holiness and righteousness that is your will for us. Forgive us where we have failed in thought, word, or deed. Renew us with your miracle of gracious forgiveness. We rejoice that you never turn us away. Amen.
Satisfied to look on him and pardon him.
Lord, we long to see the bringing in of your kingdom in its fullness. We pray for the help of your Holy Spirit to lead and guide where there is war and terrorism, destroying lives and creating fear. And where there is violence in our streets and in our homes, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the help of your Holy Spirit to lead and guide where people are hungry and thirsty, where disasters and disease are taking lives, and where our foolishness is destroying our planet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the help of your Holy Spirit to lead and guide where refugees and asylum seekers look for safety, and where the homeless seek a home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In a few moments of quiet, we hold before the Lord those known to us who are in trouble, sorrow, need, or sickness, and those who grieve the death of a loved one. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
And a closing prayer. May Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and in miracles the wonder of his saving presence, renew us day by day with his heavenly grace and sustain us in all the tomorrows to come. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.